Most respected speaker for today's virtual CP seminar, CA Divya Abhishek from Chennai. Vice Chairman and Secretary, CA Shubhrata sir. Immediate past chairman, CA MC Jayaprakash. Treasurer, CA Dinesh K. Kumar. Managing committee member, CA Saju Sridhar. All the illustrious past chairman of the Kannur branch, fellow members in the profession, friends, and my dear students, a very good afternoon to all of you. As you all are aware, that the Ministry of Corporate Affairs have come up with a lot of amendments to the company law, including Companies Accounts Amendment Rule, Amendment to Schedule 3 to the Companies Act, Companies Audit and Auditors Second Amendment Rule, and a lot more. Today, to keep us updated about the latest changes in the Companies Act 2013 and also its impact on audit and auditor, we have with us the young and pleasant face of the profession, CA Divya Abhishek, CS CMA LLB, and the qualification leads to Advanced Diploma in International Taxation UK, Diploma in IFRS with the ACCA London, Certificate in International Tax Law and Transfer Pricing Netherlands. Undoubtedly, she is a reservoir of knowledge. Dear ma'am, we are extremely thankful to you for accepting our invitation in your very busy professional schedule. And on behalf of the Kannur branch of the SERC of ICI, I extend a very warm welcome to you to this virtual CP seminar of the Kannur branch. Welcome you, ma'am. I also place on record my sincere appreciation and great gratitude to C. Abhishek Murali sir, the past secretary and member of the Southern India Regional Council, for the help and support he is extending to our Kannur branch. Dear ma'am, please extend our best wishes and regards to Abhishek sir. I also extend a very warm welcome to all the managing committee members, all the senior members in the profession, friends, and to my dear students. Welcome you all. Members, please remember to fill and submit the Google form, which is already shared in our group, to get the mandatory CP credit. And now I request CA MC Jayaprakash, the immediate past chairman of the Kannur branch, to formally introduce CA Divya Abhishek to the participants. Please.
Thank you, Raji. Very, very good afternoon to all of you. Most respected chairman of Kannur branch, CA PJ Raji, the respected faculty of today's seminar, CA Divya Abhishek from Chennai, my MC members, past chairman, members of the profession, and my dear student friends. I'm extremely honored and delighted by getting this great opportunity to introduce before you a rare personality, the dynamic lady of our profession, CA Divya Abhishek from Chennai. CA Divya Abhishek is a practicing chartered accountant at Chennai. She's a Bachelor of Commerce from Madras University, fellow member of the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India, and associate member of the Institute of Company Secretaries of India. She's a qualified cost and management accountant also. She's a graduate in law, having passed her LLB examination with the flying colors. She had secured All India 46th rank in the Chartered Accountancy final exam and All India 23rd rank in the Company Secretary examination conducted by ICSI. She also secured the All India 4th rank in the International Taxation examination conducted by the Chartered Institute of Taxation UK. She has qualified in the proficiency test of independent directors conducted by the Indian Institute of Corporate Affairs. CA Divya Abhishek has completed a diploma in IFRS with the ACCA London, and she has obtained her certification in international tax law and transfer pricing from Leiden University, Netherlands, International Tax Center, under the guidance of the world-renowned Professor Kees van Raad. She has also attended special session at Harvard University. Dear friends, CA Divya Abhishek is the youngest professional to reach this great milestone. Divya had her schooling at the reputed Vidya Mandir School, Chennai, and she was adjudged as the best outgoing student of Vidya Mandir School. She did her articleship training with EY in the Audit and Assurance Division. And after qualifying as a chartered accountant, she continued to work with EY in Audit and Assurance Division. During her term in the ENY. She was also selected a team constituted by ENY as a special task force to deal with the impact of Companies Act, which also involved a presentation and a discussion at various MNCs. CA Divya is a prolific speaker, and she has addressed over 800 conference seminars and workshop organized by corporate forums, professional bodies, etc., etc. She also held in the Southern various CAs of ICAI. She has been on Corporate Governance Committee during the year 2016-17, 19-20, and 21-22, International Taxation Committee during 2017-18. Apart from the ICAI position, she was also she was the first secretary of Business Development and Trade Relations to the Honorary Council of Zambia in South Asia. South India. She was the treasurer of the Federation of Indian Chamber of Commerce and Industry for Women for the year 19-20 and 20-21. She is the youngest ever president of the Inner Wheel of the Rotary Club of Madras. And apart from this, she was the co-chairperson of the Women Empowerment Committee constituted by the Hindustan Chamber of Commerce for the period 2015-16, etc., etc. She is a member of the Madras Gymkhana Club, Madras Cricket Club, Presidency Club, etc., etc. And as far as her passionate professional focus is concerned, CA Divya Abhishek is a firm advocate of the principle of giving back to the society, which she was embedded from childhood. And as the president of the Inner Wheel Club of Madras, Next Gen played a pivotal role in the upliftment and education of the underprivileged girl children. Apart from all her achievement, I feel that she has got a very good and great achievement as the wife of our immediate past secretary of the SARC of ICA, CA Dr. Abhishek Murali, and daughter-in-law of the great past Central Council member, our own CA Murali, sir. With these few words, I am proudly introducing before you the dynamic faculty and personality, our own CA Divya Abhishek. Thank you, Rajit. Thank you for this great opportunity to introduce this great personality. Thank you. Thank you all.
Thank you, Jabresh, for the introduction. And now I request CA Divya Abhishek ma'am to kindly proceed for the presentation. Please, ma'am.
Thank you so much, Jayaprakash sir, for such a kind and humble introduction. I am really, really humbled by it. I extend my thanks to you, the ever so dynamic chairman, Reggie sir. In fact, as soon as these notifications came out, he immediately reached out. That is the kind of effort he takes to ensure that the branch members understand what is happening at the latest live level. I think that's very important to disseminate this kind of knowledge to members at the earliest, so that not only that they are informed, but they're also confidently informing their clients. So thank you so much, sir. I've always closely followed the kind of programs you've been organizing. You've done a wonderful job with the rest of your team. Thank you, Dinesh Kumar sir, Raju sir, and Shivaprasad sir for having me here today. I also recognize the presence of the past chairman, and I'm very humbled by their presence. I would like to extend my gratitude and thanks in this regard. Now, without further ado, let's dive right into the topic for today. In fact, when we see recent amendments in Companies Act 2013, we're very confused. We feel Companies Act came out in 2013, but every other month, every other branch is holding a program. Whether they did not think this out properly when they gave it in 2013, for it has so many amendments. But friends, what I want to remind you today is this session is going to be very important, not just for a practicing CA, but the kind of amendments that MCA has brought out today is going to affect every member, whether you're the client facing, whether you're the top management, whether you're the auditor, or even whether if you're the board member. That is the kind of implication these amendments are going to carry. It is may I request all members to go on mute, please? Thank you. It is not that this was not well thought out. What MCA is increasingly doing as a regulator is to ensure. Now, earlier, when we see a financial statement, it was felt that what an investor or a stakeholder expects from it, there is a gap between what the financial statement is showing and what you are expecting. It was felt that when you read an Indian company's balance sheet, it was not very transparent. So So increasingly, MCA has tried to bridge this gap by bringing out very, very relevant provisions. Now you may ask me, is this a good thing? Definitely, as practicing chartered accountant, as auditors, what they have released in March 24, 2021 provides as an insurance. We will understand why through the course of our session. I first want to address the most important question. When is this going to be applicable? Now, please remember, friends, that is why understanding the notifications and interpreting them correctly becomes important. When it first came out, it said with effect from April 1st, 2021. Now, naturally, there's a lot of panic because you bring out a notification on 24th and you say it is applicable in 6 days. So there's a lot of representations that went in. Immediately, they turned around on April 2nd, 2021. They revised all of these notifications and said applicability is only going to be from 1st April 2022. Now, as soon as I say this, a lot of us might wonder, okay, something that is going to be applicable 1 year from now, why did Kannur branch organize today? What is it? Why is it relevant? Hold that thought. That is where the session for today becomes important for two primary reasons. One, when this becomes applicable for your March 31st, 2022 balance sheet, you have to show comparative numbers for March 31st, 2021. Thereby, if you know what these provisions are, before you do the audit for 2021, if you incorporate as a part of your audit work paper, next year your job will be easier. You might not feel the extra work. Why I say extra work is there are 31 amendments. The balance sheet that we see today, there'll be 31 amendments in the balance sheet that we're going to be seeing tomorrow. Second reason, many amendments that we find here seems to become applicable from the first quarter of 2021 itself. Thereby, you need to guide your clients, guide the management, what these changes are and how they need to prepare for these changes. Definitely, because these changes have come, your disclosure requirement is going to be extensive. You need to check better if the controls are working. Auditor responsibility has been enhanced. So you need to plan ahead. If you need to inform your client, if there's any discussion that is going to happen on the fee aspect or anything else in terms of the scope of work that is going to come in for you as an auditor and your team member. So audit planning is also need to be improved. The last two that we see, why I said this has come as an insurance cover for auditors like us, is because we are all aware, CARO 2020, it came out 1 year back, which has also been deferred till 31st March 2022. So now what they've done is, it was felt as auditors, we are required to say so many things in this new CARO. Where is the management saying anything? So now MCA has brought all this and said, now the management has to first say it in the balance sheet so that when the auditor issues an opinion in CARO 2022, they will be in tandem. Now the last point is something to me that is going to affect every company that we have during as our audit, which is going to be change in the accounting software with effect from 1st April 2022. Every company shall use a software which has a feature of recording audit trail of each and every transaction, creating edit log of the changes. Now, what it simply means, every company, which means there is going to be no exemption from any company which is using a software, it now has to ensure there is an audit trail for that software for every single transaction. And at a later date, the auditor should be able to download this audit trail and analyze it. Now, why should the auditor download? Please remember, friends, when they have brought a change for the company and management, they've also included this for the auditor to comment on his report. They didn't just stop there. They said, yes, the auditor has to ensure that the audit trail cannot be deleted. Very, very debilitating. For example, your company might be using Excel. Let me remind you, Excel is also a software. Since we do not have any exemptions, for a company using Excel, they need to now see, is there an audit trail facility? You and I are aware there is no audit trail facility for Excel. Let's go one step ahead. Let's take a scenario where your company is using an existing Tally software. There is a lot of concern after this notification came where people asked me, Now, because I have to create this trail, audit trail cannot be deleted. Can I not make mistakes at all? I make 1,000 rupees sale. By mistake, my accountant recorded as 100. Now, can I not make any change? Now, the answer is no, my friends. You can definitely make change. But what you cannot do, you cannot go delete that 100 rupees entry. What you should do is to pass a 900 rupee entry, or you pass a reversal entry and pass a new entry. So all this notification is saying is that for any entry that a company passes, you cannot delete that entry. It should be tracked somewhere when the entry is being passed. As an auditor, you need to download and check this. Now let's take another and very common scenario. Most companies we know, when they close their March 31st, they do not close on 31st March. They typically close in May. Now, in this scenario, they might pass some provision entries, because we know as auditors, we will go tell them and that's when they pass it. Whether because of this issue, can they not be passed? Now, again, the answer is no. You can definitely pass the provision entry. What you cannot do anymore is, earlier in tally, we used to put 31st March as date, but pass the entry on 30th May. Now you have to put the date as 30th May only with effect from 31st March. So all these changes are going to now have a tight hold on the company's accounting. For the very, very first time, MCA has went and messed with the internal affairs of a company. They've taken control of that. Usually they used to give how balance sheet has to come, how it has to be reported, what management needs to do. Now they've said the very software you have to look into. Now, as soon as this rule came out, I went and checked which company has to mandatory have a software basis. Very clearly, the Companies Act Section 120, read with Rule 27, says it is only mandatory for your listed companies and for companies which have more than 1,000 shareholders. But today, you and I know any company at least has its accounts in Excel. We no longer have ledgers and books. So if you ask me, this rule becomes inapplicable, because automatically most of our companies are keeping it in the computer, which automatically means this becomes applicable. Now, as I already said, because this has been imposed on the management, there is a lot of onus as auditors for us to check which software they're using, edit facility is there, whether any deletion is there. More importantly, you are required to comment whether the software has been preserved for a period of 8 years. So please inform your management of this rule immediately. Even though only 1 year later it is going to be applicable, friends, we know that if they are using any software which does not cater to this requirement, it is not easy. They need to transition. They need to pass over the opening balance. So many aspects need to be considered. There are some questions whether the smallest company should suffer. As of now, there is no exemption at all. So as during the course of your audit this year itself, I urge all of you to ask questions, whether they have the edit log facility, what software they're using, keep them aware, because many companies, they might not pass entries on a real-time basis. One accountant will come once a month and pass it for them. You can no longer do such things, because explaining at a later date might become a little difficult. So in my view, this is one of the clauses that needs immediate acting upon to just ensure the client also follows this. It is a very good provision. It prevents your teaming and lading entries, window dressing. It adheres a lot of fraud prevention, the security. So definitely in the right direction. In fact, as an auditor, if you have your DSA degree, now is the time for you to put it to use to educate others and ensure this is done. When this rule came out, I tried to check with different softwares that most of our clients are using. And broadly, what you see on the screen, your Tally, SAP, Zoho Books, QuickBooks, these are very commonly used software. The good news is already your Zoho, QuickBooks and SAP has these. Even the basic version has something called as an audit log or activity log. So all you need to send an email to your client, ask them to activate that audit log. Please remind them, at no point of time they can disable this log. The minute they disable, as an auditor, you will have to report that, because this requirement is going to be for every transaction and to ensure it is there continuously throughout the year. Unfortunately, for those using Tally, something needs to be looked into in this regard, where I notice even though the basic version of Tally or even the prime version that came out last year, it has something called as an audit log, but it only tracks who paid last. It does not track the entire log, which is a requirement. Just 2 weeks back, Tally has come out with a revised version. It's an enhanced version that your client needs to specifically speak and get it from them, which caters to the provisions of audit log. We still do not have full clarity what are the headings an audit log should have and all of that, which will shortly come through the guidance note. Now, let's take a scenario. You have a company, a client who has a company, but very few transactions because for whatever reason, business didn't pick up. Now, they don't even want to move to Tally. They are saying, I will only stick to Excel. As of date, we do not have clarity. It says any software and Excel is a software. So whether where there is going to be no further exemption, when you report in your audit report, whether you need to qualify because they did not have accounting software, again, the answer is no. There is a space in other matters para where you need to mention that they have not transitioned, but this does not automatically require a qualification as long as you've done control procedure and all the other aspects to convince yourself that even though they do not have edit log facility, the company's controls are still in place. So I don't feel the need to qualify this report. So this change has come. It is going to be effective from 1st April 2022. The next change that has come is in your board report. Now, two logical changes they've made to the report of board of directors, where they've said, if any application or proceeding is pending under IBFC, then they need to mention the status of this insolvency bankruptcy code. This has come in the right direction because we have seen many companies go through the insolvency and bankruptcy proceedings. So this is to ensure that for the stakeholder, they are aware that something of this sort is happening with the company so that they will know how safe their investment is or whether any further change needs to be made. The second amendment is very interesting, friends, where now we are aware MSMEs are allowed to go in for a one-time settlement scheme where they're not able to meet their liabilities. Now, what MCA has said is, we typically feel when a company goes to the bank for availing a loan, it shows a very enhanced asset position so that they get a higher limit. But when a company comes for this one-time settlement, they show a lower position so that they can pay lesser. Now, they want to bridge this gap by logically saying the board of directors are responsible. If there is going to be a difference between these two valuations, the board is going to be responsible to explain why it is not the case. So please ensure that you are made aware. Whatever valuation is being done today is being looked with microscopic lens, and there's going to be onus on the board also to report on this. So kindly ensure any valuation your client does, they either run it past you to know that it is based on correct forecast and correct guidelines. The next and most significant part of our discussion today is going to be the additional disclosures required in financial statements. As sir correctly said, there are multiple changes in Schedule 3, which is going to affect how we prepare the balance sheet. What we see today is a very different balance sheet than what we are going to be seeing in the near future. When we talk about Schedule 3, it is split into three divisions. The first division is specifically for accounting standards. Second division is for your Ind AS company as per notification on 6/4/2016. Ind AS is typically for the larger companies with net worth of 250 crores or more, banks, financial institutions, which will typically not affect most of our clients. The last is, of course, for NBFCs, which follow Ind AS, which has been in effect from 2018. Now, when we see the changes that have come out front, as I already said, there are 31 amendments in this balance sheet, and it is going to affect the first division, which automatically means every single company that we see, we are minimum going to have 31 changes. Over and above the 31 changes, for Ind AS, another 4 changes are there, and for NBFC, another 1 change is there. So we are going to stick to the 31 amendments that are going to be key and affecting us practically during the audit, so that we can plan this year itself when we go for audit and ensure it is being done. When I saw how these amendments were largely structured, as I already said, the first set of changes are to ensure that it is in line with CARO. Now, naturally, this is logical. This is an insurance cover for auditors where it was felt, first let the management report on the balance sheet, then the auditor can comment on it in CARO. The second changes are very new. clauses that are new, laws that are very different from the Companies Act, which we need to be aware of and inform the management, because management is the one who's going to report on these changes. The third kind is, of course, in the nature of reclassification, rewording certain items. For example, your fixed assets became tangible assets. Now they renamed it as property, plant and equipment in line with your AS 10 revise. So some very logical how you present the balance sheet, which will only affect the presentation and disclosure, but not the number game. Let us start with the new changes that is completely going to affect the way in which we read the laws currently. The first change that has come is in the nature where every company is now required to disclose every single promoter who holds share in the company. They don't just stop there. They further go and say they need to show the percentage change during the year. Now, why is this important? How is it relevant? It was felt that when you are a stakeholder reading a balance sheet, you need to understand what the promoter does. Let's take a scenario, a promoter has less than 5%, but suddenly we find in the next year he's fully liquidated his share. So you as a reader will be of concern. You'll want to know, why did the promoter go out of the company? The person who perceives how the company is run, on whose direction the board has been acting upon, how did it change? So this is already there for companies which follow LODR regulations. Now they've brought it into this as well. You can no longer just say how much holding, you need to show the movement also. This is more of a reporting that is required. I'm sure as auditors, we're already checking this. Promoter, who's a promoter? It's a promoter as defined in your Companies Act 2013. While the first two clauses, something we will all check, I want to draw your attention to this third clause, where it says, in accordance with whose advice, directions or instructions, the board of directors or companies are accustomed to act. So during the course of our audit, we need to find out what we don't see in the paper, what we don't see in the MOA or AO, whether there is any person who has a strong hold over the decisions of the board of directors. Again, I think a lot of soft clauses are there where you do not have a specific answer. Now, management can always say no, but there might be some person, but you need to ensure you devise additional procedures to check whether this promoter, anybody is there who holds share with the company, and to understand the nature of his relationship with the company. The second clause has been non-usage of borrowings from banks or financial institutions for the specific purpose for which it is taken at the balance sheet date. So please remember, we have had multiple clauses. In fact, your CARO, earlier CARO 2005 had this clause. It was struck off in 2016. It's been reintroduced in 2020. Where it says whether term loans are being used for the purpose for which it is obtained. Now they've generalized and said any borrowing that is there in your balance sheet from banks or financial institutions, you need to specify whether it is used for the purpose for which it was taken. Now you might think that all these new changes, only the management has to say, why am I concerned as an auditor? But friends, please remember, this balance sheet that the management is giving to you, you are going to be signing on it. So automatically, even though the Schedule 3 is only for the management and only CARO 2020 is your report, indirectly you will still be held liable if you don't check. So the one way we should check this clause and also inform the management is every loan agreement that is outstanding as at balance sheet date, that needs to be checked whether it is being used for the specific purpose for which it was taken. Now in another branch, when I speak in, someone said, is it not enough if we just get an MRL? Now unfortunately, we can never rely just on an MRL. While a management representation letter is an additional proof that this is what the management has declared, as auditors, we need to do extensive checking of every agreement, what purpose, how was it spent, to ensure we comment on this clause currently. The third change is very unique, friends. Now, we are aware that over the last 2 years, multiple companies, over 2 lakh companies have been struck off. But now they want to very specifically show this on the face of balance sheet, where a company has any nature of transaction, whether in the form of investment, receivable, payable, whatever the nature, with a struck off company, it needs to disclose that. Now we might wonder, how will we know? A company has 1,000, 2,000 vendors. How will they possibly manage to get this data? Now 2-3 aspects might indicate this. Supposing your balance outstanding is going to be for a very long period of time, naturally you need to investigate and understand why it is outstanding for so long. Second, your MCA portal itself, in your MCA services column, the image that you see here, it gives you the entire list of struck off companies. So as an auditor, we cannot just blindly rely on what the management has given. we need to go check this portal in random. We'll be able to check if some vendors are there, vendors who have no response to the company, whether they're still in existence. Now, all these clauses, as we read, are to ensure transparency to the stakeholders. Minute they see, okay, you have an investment in a struck off company, automatically the next question from any regulator is going to be, why did you not write it off? So please remember, this clause is new, it is different. It is worthwhile that as auditors this year itself, when we send out your debtors and creditors confirmation, you can add a line whether your company has been struck off. Now it is for them to say yes or no, but at least you have third party evidence, and we know in SA how important third party confirmation is taken. So as auditors, we can absolve ourselves of some risk where a company has multiple vendors to avoid any issues in this clause. The next is in cryptocurrency. Now, increasingly, we hear this word a lot more. While India does not have any specific law, they've come out with times and said, if a company has any transaction where they've gained profit loss or investment in cryptocurrency, they need to show it on the face of balance sheet. Now, the one aspect how this might become applicable, let us take a scenario where you have a holding company in India, multiple subsidiaries abroad. Now, we know in multiple countries abroad, they have legalized the usage of cryptocurrency. Therefore, if there is any transaction that one subsidiary has, so when you prepare your consolidated statements, you need to now ensure that you report specifically what was towards cryptocurrency, what was a regular investment. Certain other new changes or charges are not satisfied or yet to be registered beyond the statutory period. Now, this is not any charge. Most companies adhere to the 30, 90 and 210 day limit, but those companies who do not register their charges at all, you need to mention here. Compliance with number of layers. Now, we know the Companies Act restricts only up to 2 layers of any company to have, unless it has come through a process of acquisition where certain exemptions are there. If you acquire a foreign company which has more than 2 layers, then you still comply with this. So these are merely come here to fit whether the compliance as per Companies Act has been adhered to. If you have not adhered to, then you have to report on it specifically. Compliance with approved schemes of arrangement, utilize the borrowed funds to ultimate beneficiaries. This is something I will discuss separately. CSR disclosure also I will discuss separately. I've said earlier, and I want to reiterate, the reasoning behind these amendments, these 31 amendments, is primarily because of the enhanced responsibility created on an auditor through your CARO 2020 report. Your earlier CARO had 21 clauses and 21 subclauses. Now we have 47 subclauses. Many new clauses, up to 7 new clauses have come, 7 have been modified. You have 7 retained and 1 deleted. So please remember how we even report on the CARO is going to change for 31st March 2022. Again, this is not going to be applicable for 31st March 2021. But the kind of additions that have come out, unless we do a dry run this year, we will not be effectively able to plan our audits for 31st March 2022. As we are aware, CARO has certain applicability criteria. It exempts those companies that have paid up capital or reserve surplus which is less than 1 crore, loans less than 1 crore, total revenue less than 10 crore. If all these conditions are satisfied, then it is not going to be applicable. However, whatever provision we discuss today with pertinence to Schedule 3, it is going to be applicable to every company. So even though your CARO 2020 has these exemptions, there is going to be no exemption from all those aspects that we are discussing today for the management of every company. Whether it is going to be applicable for government company, whether it is going to be applicable for Section 8 company, the answer is absolutely yes. One interesting change that they have come out in line with your CARO 2020 is the requirement to disclose the 11 ratios that we see on the screen. As you can see, the ratios cover your debt equity, cover your turnover, profitability, and your capital employed. So all aspects of what a user will need from the balance sheet is covered in this ratio. Now, typically, friends, this is going to be the role of an analyst, the role of a credit rating agency. It is surprising that they've now put this on the management of the company and additionally for the auditor to comment on this. Very, very piquant clause, but this is in line with the global standards of how comprehensive income statements are prepared. What we might need to check is there is no guidance on what comes in numerator and what comes in denominator. So every company might have a different manner in which the same ratios are being captured. So in your notes to accounts, you have to mention the formula you use to capture it. Secondly, and this is going to really change the game of these ratios, if there is any variance beyond 25% on a year-on-year basis between the ratios, the management has to give clear explanation as to why there was a variance. Now, variance is going to be practically happening. Now, let us take a scenario because of Corona, your company is going to take more loans. Automatically, your debt equity ratio is going to change. So please keep the management posted of this, because the minute you have variances, you have explanation, it is going to get more regulators onto your company to check and understand why it is so, how there is more than 25%. But if they're aware of this aspect, if they already compute the ratio as of 31st March, they will, with knowledge of what the change is going to be, whether it's practically required, they'll be able to take the right decision during the course of 2021-22 year. So that when you prepare for 2022, you are very clear what ratios are variance, what ratio there isn't. As I already said, the first is the requirement for the management to do it. Now, CARO 2020 has told every auditor, after considering these financial ratios, aging schedule, realization, and other information, what is unique here is auditor's knowledge of management plan opines that there is no material uncertainty and the company is capable of meeting its liability. Very, very significant clause. For the first time, we as auditors need to comment openly in your CARO 2020 report that the company is solvent. Now, let us take a scenario. We have not done enough work. This was a very last minute clause for us. We didn't take too much time. But 2 weeks later, the company goes for insolvency bankruptcy. Then automatically, what you gave in your CARO report becomes wrong. And we are aware, code of ethics and various disciplinary issues that will arise for something that is a material deviance. So please ensure this is going to be a very heavy responsibility on the auditor of the company to give this kind of an assurance. Unless we have these analytics done, we spend enough time understanding the solvency. If a company is going to have heavy borrowings, we need to ask further questions to understand the management's plan, board resolutions, representation letter. We might be saved under these clauses. There are certain other clauses that I've introduced just directly in line with your CARO 2020. One is in the area of where a company is doing revaluation. Now, we know for Ind AS companies, they're allowed to opt between cost and revaluation. Other companies, generally, they do not revalue. But maybe because of Corona, they want to show a better position, so they might revalue. And if that revaluation is done and the change is more than 10% in the aggregate value, they need to mention that in your both your balance sheet as well as your CARO. Second, this valuation, any revaluation has to be done only by a registered valuer. So as chartered accountants, unless we have registered, finished the exam, registered the institute, we cannot do the valuation for revaluation. Second, title deeds of immovable property not held in the name of company. Now we know after multiple audits of family, closely held private Indian companies, many companies have land recognized in their books of accounts, but it will still be in the name of the owner. They wouldn't have done the registration. So this is the time for you to advise them to pick out all the documents and ensure that it is in line with the name of the company. Because on 31/3/22, if it is not done, you need to give the table you see here where your property, plant, equipment, if it's not held in the name of the company, you have to mention in whose name it is held and since which date it is held. It is going to be a lot more questioning. The minute you give these kind of information, they're going to ask how is it the companies, whether it was legal and all those aspects. So now is the time for you to intimate your companies, ensure that all of it is there in the registered name. This clause is not going to be applicable for leasehold land. This is only going to be applicable for property, plant and equipment, immovable property not held in the name of company. The next is loans or advances granted to your promoter, director, key managerial person, related party. You need to now specifically show how much is taken from each of these parties and what is the percentage to the total. Now, two things you need to remember here, friends. The same information you'll be giving in 40A-2B in your tax audit report. So you need to ensure both the information are the same. The second aspect is what you show notes to accounts under AS 18. The definition of related party might be different from what the management shows in Schedule 3 as per Companies Act. So please remember to do a quick verification between AS18 and Companies Act. I urge that if it is going to be additional information, it is better to give in all the places at the same time to ensure there is consistency in the balance sheet. This, in my view, is a very important provision, which is going to be details of any transaction not recorded in the books, surrendered or disclosed during the course of tax assessment. Unless there is immunity from disclosure, you will need to specifically show that it is an undisclosed income. Now, when we say tax assessment, search survey seizure stands up, because if that happens for the client surrenders some income, automatically that comes under this clause. But let me take a more common aspect, which is going to be your assessment. Now, we know after 2 or 3 years, your income tax takes up assessment, there's reopening under 148, many things. The assessing officer might make an addition. You might not go on further appeal. Whether that addition is going to come as undisclosed income? The answer is yes. But how can we save the client from showing this undisclosed income? Two ways. One, when you have the tax assessment, even though you do not go on appeal, if you disagree with the disallowance, if you have enough submissions, if you have recordings by the assessing officer that these details were provided where the assessee did not agree, but we have disallowed, then you can say that the client is not saying it's undisclosed income. We are still fighting. Just because the AO disallowed, we did not go on further appeal because we felt the cost. Now, the disallowance might be 20,000. The cost to hire a person to go on appeal might be 1 lakh. So because of that disparity, we decide to stay quiet. In those cases, you need not show this as undisclosed income. The second aspect is, as auditors, some companies might have a different tax auditor. We might be just a statutory auditor. So as a statutory auditor, you need to now check every single income tax assessment order to ensure that it does not get covered in this clause. If it does get covered, then you need to clearly mention undisclosed income under other income as a specific line item. Certain other clauses. When I started the session, I said it is not only enough that we know Companies Act 2013. We need to learn multiple laws now in order to be eligible for issuing this CARO 2020. One such law is your Benami Prohibition Act, where they have said any proceedings initiated or pending, then the auditor has to comment on these proceedings. The management has to give all the details, details of property, year of acquisition, whether that property was mentioned in the books of accounts, if not, why they didn't mention, and what proceedings were undertaken. Now, I had some questions from fellow auditors where they felt a lot of panic. They said, how do we know? How do we know some management is holding Benami property? Nobody in the right mind who's holding a Benami property is going to come and tell you, hello, auditor, this is my Benami property. Is it not? That's why the wordings of the law is very important. It very clearly says proceedings initiated or pending. So unless proceedings is initiated against a company, we do not have to worry whether they have Benami property. Of course, if over the course of audit you suspect, that is a different thing. But the reporting here is only when they have already initiated proceeding. Very common scenario, management might not divulge proceeding was initiated. How you can check is go to the legal expense schedule. If you see a high amount paid to lawyer, immediately pick up on it. So there are a lot of issues that get unearthed through this legal expenses schedule. So that is one way you can do your due diligence. Even if the management says no proceedings, you can check if it was actually initiated. Certain provisions are going to be applicable from April 1st, 2021. And this is one such provision where if you have any borrowing from bank or financial institutions on the basis of current assets and the quarterly returns that the company files with the bank does not match to the year-end audited books, then the reconciliation for the same needs to be provided. For large companies, this is no worry, friends. Anyway, you have an auditor coming quarter, coming half year, who does this? What about the smaller companies? We're all aware they take working capital limits. Now, because they take working capital limits, they have to submit this quarterly returns. Now, we know for smaller companies, we don't do stock audit. We don't check on a quarterly basis. What happens? So we should inform them. Now, 1st April to June, they'll have to prepare the stock. They have to show their inventory. Please inform your clients. This has to be at least checked by them twice before they submit it to the bank. Because in the event where year end you come out with provision entries, unnecessarily they have to disclose this on the face of financial statements that there is a difference between what the auditor gave and what the management submitted. So it is very difficult and tedious clause in my view to impose indirect auditing on smaller clients. But as of today, we don't have an exemption. Thus, it becomes imperative that we inform them. Whatever stocks, anything they submit the bank. If you notice the trend, friends, what MCA is trying to do is whatever a company gives the banker has to be approved by the auditor. Very, very indirect responsibility imposition, but good in a way that the bank also has realistic expectation from a client. It is not going to be a scenario where your client says, I have so much inventory, but here in the auditor comes, writes down the inventory, or there's a difference in physical verification and all those other aspects. As auditors, where a client exceeds your working capital limit of 5 crores, then you need to report in your CARO. Now, what you need to remember here is it says sanction limit. It does not matter if the client does not take the loan for 5 crores. As long as he has a sanction limit, then you also need to report on this clause in CARO. And it does not say year-end loan. So any time during the year, if the sanction limit is going to exceed 5 crores, automatically you need to check this provision as an auditor. Whether any person is being declared as willful defaulter, I want to clarify one aspect in this regard. Automatically, clients feel that whether they need to check with director manager if they are willful defaulters. This is specifically only for the company under picture, only for the company under audit, whether it is declared as willful defaulter. We are aware from time to time, RBI releases these lists of willful defaulter and all those aspects. So as long as you check that and ensure that the company does not fall within it, then it is okay. Certain additional reporting requirements have come out in the nature of aging schedule. Now, this again is something as auditors we do, but now we need to be doubly sure to check whether the management is disclosing the same. The first is with respect to your trade payable. You need to now give, you can no longer give it as one line item, say trade payable total amount, but this aging schedule has to form part of your balance sheet, less than 1 year, 1 to 2 years, 2 to 3 years, and more than 3 years. You see, further classification does be split between MSME, non-MSME, and disputed due. Now, when we read the word disputed due, we automatically assume only if it's in the court of law, it's disputed. The answer is no. You can always have a commercial dispute also, which is going to get covered in this clause. So please ensure you check it correctly. Now, one practical indicator can be, let us take a scenario 2020. You have a creditor. You repay it correctly, 2019, you repay correctly, but there is a due from 2017 that is not paid. So as auditors, we need to look into this. So this aging is going to shift how we see it. Now, let us take a scenario where we don't apply these provisions now, but in 2022 in the audit, we suddenly have more creditors in 3 years. Then in 2023, they write it off and we don't have anything. So again, when you give this level of information and the comparatives are going to be so different, you are bound to be questioned. So during this year, it is good to check what is going to be beyond 3 years, get management representation, inform them of the new provision and so that they write it off if it is required. Now, how do we do this aging? Usually we have with creditors a credit limit of 90 days, 60 days as per agreement. For companies that do not have that, you will take the date of transaction as the date from which you will do these aging. They've also said any due which is not billed, where you've obtained the service, typically in the case of royalty, rent, and license, you would have obtained it, but billing would have still not come. That has to be disclosed separately in the balance sheet. This is going to be a stringent reporting requirement. MSME is defined as per provisions of MSME. This is just going to be for your reference. I will definitely share the PowerPoint presentation so that you will have all these clauses in your palm. Similar to what happened for trade payables, they want the same thing to come in for trade receivables by a split between disputed and disputed. We are aware as of today, we show more than 6 months, less than 6 months. But now you need to show the entire aging even for trade receivables. Definitely anything you put beyond 2 years is going to be questioned. So it is worthwhile to ensure and advise clients to not show this level of aging. And if they keep it within your 1 to 2 years at a limit which is applicable. Practically, friends, you will have your associate enterprise or your parent company dues that is extending beyond 3 years, which can be logically explained, but any other due, typically a party is not going to wait for more than 3 years. So all these aspects need to be considered and ensured it is done correctly. There's going to be an aging for your capital work in progress also, where you need to show project-wise breakup less than 1 year, 1 to 2 years, 2 to 3 years. What's interesting here is for the first time they want the management to report for capital work in progress whose completion is overdue or exceeded its cost compared to its original plan, the completion schedule is to be given. Now, this has to be given project-wise. So, it is going to be very difficult as auditors for us to understand what was the original plan, whether they've exceeded it. So, please check this, get representations. Many companies we see the same amount of capital progress year on year. Every time you ask, they say, yes, it will be completed. Now, you can no longer be satisfied with such explanations. You need to go practically see what the budget was, what the plan was. Because the minute you give this kind of a schedule breakup, a lot of questions will arise. Another piquant clause is the projects temporarily suspended. Now, we are aware because of the situation in Corona, many companies might have temporarily suspended. You need to check whether it is actually a temporary suspension or whether they have no plans to go ahead with it. Similar to the trade, to the intangibles, to the capital work in progress, you also have this aspect of intangibles under development where you need to still show this. Now, this is more skewed towards your startup companies so that you can ensure that they have, if they have intangibles, how they have recognized whether it is going to come into this bucket of 1 to 2 years and all those aspects. At the start, we said the third aspect, the second was going to be in line with your CARO reporting. The third aspect is your presentation and disclosure, where certain reclassification was done. This is a very logical one, friends, where they've said you have to reclassify your current maturities of long-term debt from other current liabilities to short-term borrowing. Now, naturally, let us take a scenario. You've taken a 100 crore loan, correct? And 10 crores becomes payable next year. It is in the nature of short-term borrowings only. So please ensure that you remember these disclosures and disclose it correctly. As I already said, there were certain words that are changed. Now your total revenue that you see in your profit and loss account gets replaced by total income. It is assumed revenue means generally from goods or services, primary business, but the company also earns other income, scrap sales, interest income. So that total of your revenue plus that income should be called as total income. And this, there is now importance of a compulsory rounding off. So where a company has 100 crore turnover, less than 100 crore, they've given certain criteria. You need to have compulsory rounding off. This was earlier imposed on Ind AS companies. Now they've extended to all companies so that you have a good read of the financial statement. The word intangible asset has been added for the revaluation and regarding valuation, which we have already discussed. Certain provisions are going to be specific for your Ind AS companies only. Whatever we discussed so far has been there for all companies, including Ind AS companies. But over and above that, Ind AS companies now need to show, as per provisions of Ind AS 116, which came out in 2019, they need to show an additional line item of something called as lease liabilities. So this is not earlier included. Now they have correctly included that. Second, in your statement of changes in equity, you need to specifically say what came as a prior period error and what was the restated balance in the beginning. So increasingly, if you see, when you give these kind of disclosures in the balance sheet, you're going to be asked many questions on why it was a prior period error, why there has been a restatement, and many other questions. Along with the aging that we've already done, your trade receivables now needs to have an additional aging of credit impact. What is the credit terms for it? Very minor changes over and above the changes we have already discussed. The third aspect of your NBFC Division 3, you need to mandatorily show the four ratios that we see on the screen. In my view, this is a repetitive clause because already your NBFC, which has more than 500 crore, has to mandatorily give this to RBI. Now they again want you to show this in the balance sheet. Pursuant to all the changes that have come out in Schedule 3, which the management has to do, the extent of audit reporting has also been enhanced, wherein in your audit report, you need to mention certain clauses pertaining to dividend declared as per 123. The feature of audit trail, what we already spoke in the beginning on the audit trail, the auditor now has to comment whether the company is maintaining it. The one clause that is significant is going to be in the nature of the prevention of money laundering act, wherein the management represented to the best of knowledge and belief, no funds have been advanced, received or invested to any other person, including foreign entities, whether recording on writing or otherwise, shall benefit an intermediary. Now, in very layman terms, what this means is, we have seen this transaction very often, where you might have a large group, they will just transfer one bulk amount to the Indian entity. The Indian entity will automatically transfer it to three other different entities. Now you can no longer do that, friends, because they're very specifically saying where the company does not ultimately benefit from it. Okay, where the company is only being an intermediary or passing that fund on to somebody else, you have to now mention it in the balance sheet and you have to comment on it in the audit report that it is not prevent as per provisions of money laundering. So please remember, as an auditor, you need to be aware of Prevention of Money Laundering Act, you need to be aware of FEMA Act, Companies Act, and Benami Act in order to now comply and report on the various provisions of CARO 2020. What we have spoken so far, all that you've seen is just summarized into three buckets of how the what all captions in your balance sheet is going to undergo a change based on all the changes that have come out in your Schedule 3 and your CARO 2020. More logical representation is they're trying to improve transparency. If there are any closed group transactions, they want to specifically note it, control over fund movement and compliance with laws and regulations. This is just a snapshot of from when each of these MCA changes are going to be applicable for all the clients. What happens if we do not do it? Now, let us take a scenario where the management has not done it as per Schedule 3. Then the company is going to have to pay a penalty. The managing director, full-time director, CFO, and all the directors are going to be punishable with the imprisonment up to 1 year, fine up to 50,000 or 5 lakhs. Now, practically, we know unless we inform the management, they might not be fully aware. So it is important to disseminate this knowledge as professionals and also keep them aware. If you do not say anything, what the Schedule 3 has changed, if it's not being correctly disclosed, there can be a liable penalty up to 1 year or up to 5 lakhs. With that, we come to the last aspect. I will try to cover this in the next 10 minutes so that we have some time for question and answers before we wrap up for today. CSR definitely has been a very interesting provision for India. What started as just comply or explain is now become comply, explain, mandatory transfer, if not pay fine up to 1 crore. These provisions have had so much transition, be it through your Companies Act 2020 or as late as January 2021 when we got notifications. And what is interesting in these changes is it is going to be applicable for your year ended 31st March 2021 itself. Now, let us take another scenario where your client doesn't even apply for CSR. Why you should listen is, as professionals, we are now given an opportunity to undertake some certification work in CSR, wherein we can also earn and make some money from it. As we are aware, applicability is what you see on the screen, which I'm sure all of us are aware. They have now come out and defined what the CSR is. What we primarily need to remember is anything that is not done in the normal course of business will only be considered CSR. Let us take a practical scenario. Dell, the laptop company, distributed free laptops during COVID to help schools and colleges. That will not be considered as CSR because that is something they're doing in a normal course of business. It could be even considered as sponsorship for deriving marketing benefit where they send it to the Dell logo. Maybe they will go buy more. Maybe they'll buy accessories from Dell. So please remember the definition is now very clear of what is going to be CSR and what is not. One exemption they've provided is for the research and development companies, where if they undertake research in specific to COVID-19 in collaboration with institutes that they have specifically mentioned in your schedule to the CSR activities, then whatever expense you spend on that, you can take that as a CSR activity. Even though for a research and development or a pharmaceutical company, it's going to be a normal course of business, this specific exemption has been provided. One other exemption that NCA has given in Jan 13, 2021, is any company that does COVID awareness for vaccination, whatever expense you spend on it is going to be allowed as a CSR activity. So immediately I had a client ask me, I put up an ad on TV where Amitabh Bachchan washed his hands, and I feel that is going to be a CSR activity because I'm spreading awareness on hygiene, whether I can take that. Again, answer is no, friends. Whenever we see what is allowable and what is not, when he washes his hand, he's using the brand of the company. Automatically, it can be considered as a marketing activity over actual promotion of hygiene. Whenever we look at a CSR activity, we have to first see whether as per Schedule 7 to the Companies Act, it falls in any of these buckets. Let's take one simple example of how you can analyze eradication of hunger or poverty. Now, let's take a scenario where your company suddenly today is distributing food in 500 villages for today. Whether that can be CSR? Many people feel it is, but the answer is no. By just distributing food for one day, it does not become eradication of hunger or poverty. It is just a mere donation done. However, the same company is distributing for 360 days. Then they are clearly doing some activity as a social responsibility for eradicating hunger and poverty. Second, whatever you donate, whether it's a fixed asset or inventory, is not going to be CSR. However, if you supply it during a natural calamity, then you can still consider that as CSR. Certain other amendments in the nature of what is the CSR committee, what it should do. Earlier in 2019, we're all aware it was just on paper. Now companies can no longer do that. You have to mandatory have a CSR committee. They need to have a plan. This plan has to come into the company's website. The board of directors is mandatory required to show this on the website. One very interesting addition for a CFO of any company is he is now required to certify on CSR. So the CFO was nowhere involved earlier on what he needs to do with respect to CSR. It was done by the board of directors and closed there in the board report. Now the CFO is given this responsibility. So please ensure you have bulletproof CSR provisions and you need to be in line with this. Because the penalty, if you do not comply with this provision, can go up to ₹1 crore, which might really harm the company because of ignorance of the changes that have come through. And the earlier when I started your CSR provisions, I said, it is going to give significant job opportunity for a CA. Now that is where this part of the presentation becomes important. Typically, when a company has to give CSR, either it will do it on its own or it might give it to some other agency to do it on its behalf. Or if it's a very large company, it will create its own trust or society to undertake these CSR activities. Now, in a scenario where this is being done, it is called as an implementing agency. Now, what you see, this 50%, 3% directly does not matter, right? Your company itself has identified and given that CSR. The other aspect of your 39% + 4% + 4%, 47%, where typically they're doing it through another agency. Now they've come out with effect from April 1st, 2021. Any of these implementing agencies have to be registered with the MCA. Now, why this clause is important for those companies who do not know this, but are still giving it to your other implementing agency, which is not registered with MCA, it will not even be considered as a CSR activity. More importantly, this registration has to be done only by a CA, CS or a CMA. So as chartered accountants, it's definitely a job opportunity because in my understanding, not many clients are even aware of these provisions. This will be a good entryway for you to bigger clients where you make them aware that if you are doing CSR through any trust, society or a Section 8 company, you need to have it registered through your CSR 1. Second, this trust or society needs to be in existence for a period of 3 years and needs to be registered with the Income Tax Act also. So it is going to have multiple implications because typically we are aware from our experience, Section 8 company is not there for that long. A Section 8 company does not register with your income tax. So all that has changed now with effect from 1st April and it has to be complied with. The second provision, which will be a game changer, is some companies undertake very large CSR activities where they build a school, they build a hospital. So in all those cases may take 2 to 3 years. So it is going to be recognized as a CSR asset in the books of accounts of the company. Now they've come out with a new provision and said, if any company has a CSR asset, it can no longer hold it in its books of accounts. It has to create a Section 8 company or it has to transfer to an existing Section 8 company within a period of 180 days. And that period ends by 21st July 2021. So there is not much time left. If your client holds any CSR asset that you've been showing in the balance sheet, you can no longer show that as of 31st March 2022, this needs to be transferred automatically because of all these changes. Schedule 3 gives you multiple additional disclosures that need to be done. 2-3 excellent clarifications that have come out. One is with respect to carrying forward the CSR credit. Earlier, Institute said you cannot carry forward. Now, in a year where you pay excess CSR, you cannot carry that forward. Now, they've come out in Companies Act 2020 and said this can be carried forward for any number of years where a company has spent additional amount. Second, for companies which have only up to 50 lakhs CSR spending, they do not need to worry about a CSR committee. However, you still need to have CSR done. You need to have the annual plan done through your board of directors itself. The last, but in my view, a clause that will affect for companies which have CSR applicable, but who have not completely followed the provisions of spending the CSR. Because when these provisions came out, they merely said, if you have become applicable for CSR, even if you don't spend that amount, you need to just explain in your board of directors. So many companies will do a year-end provision and give an explanation that it will spend in the future. Now you can no longer give this explanation. Where you do not spend your CSR for any year, within 6 months from the end of that financial year, if you do not know where to spend, you need to transfer to a specified fund to the government as per Schedule 7. Very important provision where now you can no longer keep the CSR unspent. We would have been giving this disclosure of what is not spent and carried forward. Now specifically, you need to transfer it to a fund as instituted by the MCA and the special designated bank account. One aspect of practical uses, I've said many companies take large projects. Now, typically we know when a company takes a large project, it might not be able to finish it within a year. So MCA has recognized that and said, you have up to 3 years. So any project you undertake, up to 3 years, you can consider as CSR. Now for those projects, naturally, you might not be able to spend the whole amount. So that aspect alone, if it's an ongoing large project, you can just transfer it within 30 days from the end of the year to a specified designated bank account. Let us take a practical scenario. A regular ongoing project might be building a hospital. But another scenario where you're donating 1 crore every year, that cannot be considered as an ongoing project. It truly has to be a continuing project in order to be applicable. Why these provisions are found to be important is because the penal provisions associated with it, for a company, twice the amount of CSR or up to 1 crore can be charged, does not just stop there. Every officer in default has to have 1/10 of the amount transferred up to 2 lakhs as penalty by not complying with these provisions. To give you a summary, all these aspects that you see on the screen become mandatory for a company to disclose in the balance sheet, where you see this clause total of previous year shortfall. Please remember, friends, if you have this total of previous year shortfall, they will immediately question why you did not transfer it within 6 months to the unspent account. Whether non-compliance of provisions of CSR leads to qualification of audit report, answer is yes. The event where a company does not comply with the provisions, you will need to qualify the audit report very, very clearly. There are certain other amendments to your Companies Act 2020, which have come out in the right direction over and above what we have discussed. One is the government has decriminalized over 46 offenses. So again, some imprisonment, they've toned it down. In fact, even when CSR came out in Jan 2019, they said up to 3 years imprisonment, then they immediately struck it back. So 2020 Act softens all these stances to ensure that business is happening properly. Second is with respect to remuneration to independent directors. Important clause, section 197, where when a company was loss making, they had no mandate to pay independent directors. They were not covered under the provision. Now it was felt increasingly that the work of an independent director is almost similar to a regular director. That is the kind of roles and responsibilities that they have. So this also the Companies Act 2020 has modified. Certain exemptions have been given to NBFCs. Certain companies, typically only your listed companies, were giving periodic financial results. Now they've added more companies to this list to ensure it is done. They've defined what a listed company is and certain other provisions. Before I end the session for today, the one aspect I wanted to highlight was there's this CFSS scheme that many of our clients would have availed in December 2020, wherein any file that you have not filed in the previous years for companies LLP, a window was open where you could make those filing of those forms before 31st December 2020, and you need not pay any penalty or interest. Most clients would have availed this. But what you will need to do as a professional is up to June 30th, 2021, there's a form called E-Form CFSS, which if you do not file this form of those who avail the CFSS scheme, it does not provide you any immunity. Tomorrow, this form is not being filed. whatever form that you filed for December 2020, the MCA might pick up and do prosecution. There's going to be no immunity from you in this respect. So I've tried to concise the multiple changes that have come out today into the discussion to ensure that we have some time for question and answers. I'm happy to share any the PPT with the branch chairman, as well as anyone who has further doubts, feel free to reach out to me by email. I'm always happy to help and share. With that, I would like to thank the Kannur branch for having me here today, but more importantly for disseminating timely knowledge whenever there are changes that come to help fellow auditors as well. Thank you so much for the opportunity. It was a true pleasure addressing the branch, and I hand it back over to the chairman. Any questions any of you have, please feel free to post it on the chat box. I can just read it out from there, or you can unmute yourself, whichever is going to be more suitable to take it forward. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much. It was a very useful knowledge sharing presentation. It was a seamless presentation for the last 1.5 hours nearly. And the members and students, now the floor is open, and you can unmute, either you can unmute and ask, or otherwise you can put the questions in the chat box. Ma'am is ready to answer.
Okay. Please discuss regarding FAQ on CSR issued regarding provisioning amount to be spent under CSR. I think this is not very clear, but from what I interpret is, whether whatever amount you have not spent on CSR, whether you need to now spend it, the answer is yes. The government has very clearly said, the NCA, that whatever amount is unspent, which has to be actually spent, because they are aware that 2% of average net profit of last 3 years is to be spent for those companies for which CSR becomes applicable. So in this scenario, whatever is unspent, you have to transfer it within 6 months. That is before September 30th, you have to transfer it to the necessary fund as issued by Schedule 7 of the Companies Act. What will be your advice to the client working on tally for the impact of audit trail issued by MCA? I think a good question from Sounder. Definitely one is, you need to talk to your tally developer. As I said, they have now come out with an advanced version. So you need to check with them and ensure they have, the client gets it before April 1st, 2022 to comply with the provisions, because your existing tally version does not have it. However, they have now come out with the advanced version in line with the change that has come out for them to prepare on the same. Whether companies with hotel business supplying food for free during COVID lockdown can be considered CSR activity. Again, excellent question from Najab. What we have read is, during the periods of natural disasters or calamities, whatever donation is done will be considered as CSR. Since COVID has been declared as one, it will be considered as CSR activity during the course of COVID. But otherwise, if this is being done, it will not be considered. How audit trail changes will have an impact on audit of information provided by an entity in ICFR. So when we read ICFR, the period changes. Now audit trail is going to be required for the entire year, while for ICFR, it is going to be asset balance sheet date. So in a scenario where your audit trail was maintained, but for whatever reason, it was disabled at some point of time, it might not affect your ICFR report because that is a year-end reporting. However, it is going to affect the audit trail in the audit report clause that you will be reporting on. Secondly, multiple clients even till date did not have audit trail, but we did not feel the need to qualify your ICFR report. So just because a client does not have audit trail, we cannot presume or assume that the controls are not being followed. There will be genuine reasons, so it needs to be looked on a client-to-client basis only. Is it mandatory required to make provisions the books of accounts for unspent amount of CSR requirement? Yes. So if CSR is going to be applicable, then by meaning of unspent is only if you've provided for in the books, it will remain as unspent because you've made a provision, but you've not spent yet. So whatever is the CSR that is applicable for the company, you need to provide for that in your books of accounts. If you have spent, well and good. If it is unspent, you need to transfer it to the fund, as I've mentioned. Is it mandatory to keep books of accounts in software? If the company is keeping books manually, audit trail is not available. Section 120 very clearly says it is only mandatory for listed companies and companies with more than 1,000 shareholders to have it in software. So if voluntarily your company is maintaining it in hard copy book, no problem at all. This provision is not going to be applicable for you, Sridhar. It is not going to be a violation either. So currently tally has a feature delete an entry. Will it make the tally not good? So that's why Najab, the advanced version caters to the audit trail, where even if the client decides to delete the entry, it will be mentioned in the audit trail. So the whole point of having this edit log facility in audit trail is every action towards a journal entry will get recorded there. So this is something you need to inform your client and have a conversation with Tally to ensure that it is compliant. Automatically, if anybody is going to delete an entry, when the audit trail is enabled, it will mention that a entry was deleted. So automatically, it's going to be a red flag for the auditor to check it. The transactions by the source to the intermediary happens on the first month, and the transaction by intermediary to beneficiary happens on the first or fourth month. Will time gap have an impact on identification and how to do identify this nexus? So this is a valid question, because in fact, this clause of ultimate beneficiary is very, very tedious on the auditor as well as the client. How are we to know what amount was diverted? How are we to go check? So two aspects you can do to check whether this is being followed. One is in your loan agreement itself, or in the case where you're investing in the investment agreement itself, you have a very specific clause that you are providing this only under the understanding that the person who receives it uses it. Second is to get confirmation from that respective party at the end of the year to ensure that this is being done correctly. Now, third, multiple companies still will have your holding subsidiary understanding. What they want to say is you will have to disclose it under your management clause in the Schedule 3. But what the law wants to understand is whether there has been any money laundering. Now, many people, less than 5% of the entities from what results show, use these provisions to launder money and save on tax. To avoid that is why this clause has come into play. So definitely as auditors, we have to read your FEMA Act, Money Laundering Act, before we comment on this clause. Is there any standard for calculation of ratio analysis and its disclosure? As of date, no. But we're expecting a guidance note from ICAI very shortly to give us clarification on this, because as I already said, if in the event where we do not get that, we very clearly inform what formula each company has used in your disclosure aspect to the notes to accounts. And secondly, we already give 4 of these ratios in Form 3CD to our tax audit report. So we need to ensure that there is some consistency between the ratios that we show on the balance sheet and in the tax audit report, so that later that does not get questioned. Does with undisclosed principles while doing financial transaction will have any impact on intermediary investments or trusts, which are not in the form of company? Trusts generally are going to be your cooperative society registered under Trust Act. That is not even going to come into this picture unless a company has transactions with them, which is also not too common. But in the event where it is going to affect a company, yes, definitely. I think there's a question from Sivaprasad. Companies preparing books of accounts in Tally and presenting the printout for audit, what will be the impact if the company is not a listed one? Unfortunately, there is going to be no exception to an unlisted entity. You can no longer accept this printout for your audit. You need to ask for the Tally backup, check the Tally, and you yourself need to do an IT verification. So that's why these amendments are very significant, friends, because you can no longer just accept what is given. You also need to innovatively change the way you do the audit. You have to go to the base software, you have to get the backup and check accordingly, and also download the audit trail feature. Does all additional disclosure comparative figure is required? For example, change promoter shareholding? Yes. So if whatever you report in 2022, you need to have a comparative of 2021. So yes, you will need to disclose everything in line with 2021 also. It is advisable to include all these changes in your working paper today itself, when you go for the audit for 31st March 2021. Do we have any further questions?
The chat box, is the questions are over.
Yes. I think just two more. As far as lease accounting is concerned, Ind AS 116 agreement consists two separate obligations, say rent for property and maintenance. And in such a case, whether ROU is required to be made for both payment obligations, or we need to consider separately. So if it is two separate obligations, you can consider it separately, sir. It has to be read in terms with the agreement, and then the treatment accordingly needs to be done. the companies in the activity of doing any business on any activity covered in Schedule 7, in addition to its normal course, still it has to follow the 2% investment. Yes, sir. I think the minute your CSR gets triggered, irrespective, even if you are a charitable enterprise under Section 8, you will still need to follow the provisions of CSR. It is applicable for every entity, even though you're already doing a charitable activity, if you have the limit. But typically, sir, I don't think charitable enterprise even cross net profit of 5 crore. This situation looks unlikely unless it's a very large company for which you will still need to follow.
But as far as the small, the compliance cost of the small companies are concerned, that would be the great problem. Different companies, yes, government companies, they may not be possible to comply with all these requirements.
Because we would have actually, before partnership firm and LLP became popular, most of our clients would have started as a company. Now, unfortunately, the burden of their reporting has definitely increased. That's why by preparing ahead, even for us as auditors, the time we are going to spend on auditing and checking is going to be higher. So the more prepared and more equipped we are, it becomes a little easier next year when these changes come into picture.
So Divya ma'am, once again, I thank you for all your support and guidance to the Connor branch. And once the pandemic is over, it will be our pleasure to have you for a physical meeting, ma'am.
Definitely, sir.
And now I request the secretary of the branch, C.S. Shupasa, sir, kindly propose the formal vote of thanks. Please, sir.
Presiding officer, chairman of Kannur branch, chartered accountant P.J. Reji, auspicious learned speaker, brilliant and outstanding chartered accountant Divya Abhishek, my dear professional colleagues, knowledge is power. Today we have witnessed such a power in our faculty, CA Divya Abhishek. She has proved as an exceptionally talented and very promising chartered accountant. Really, it was an outstanding presentation made by the faculty, CA Divya, on the topic, Recent Amendments in Companies Act 2013. The entire fraternity of Chartered Accountants of Kannur branch are very grateful to CA Divya Abhishek for being with us, spending her valuable time, sharing her valuable knowledge, and for her exceptional presentation on this topic. And we wish her all success. We look ahead to her continued support, association with our Kannur branch, and continued support in our future programs also. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir.
I express our sincere gratitude to the chairman of Kannur branch, Chartered Accountant P.J. Reji, for presiding over the seminar and for his outstanding leadership. We are very much thankful to all the participants, members, for your support, motivation, and for your gracious presence in this seminar. Thank you. Be safe and be happy.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you.
Please
thank
share you. Your presentation so that we can...
Definitely, sir. Definitely. I'll also share my email ID. If I didn't address any doubt, you can feel free to write to me. And I'll share the presentation with the chairman of Kannur branch and he will enter this activity. Yeah. Thank you, sir.